This impressive White Scout car was built in 1943 during the Second World War and is just part of one of the largest privately owned collections of military equipment in the UK. In just a moment, I'll tell you where we are and why it has such a special significance for where we are today. Today, it's a love of the arts that's driving an imaginative twosome to head south. And imaginations are allowed to run wild.
Simple, elegant, but functional.
Yes.
Works well.
Thought I was talking about you for a minute there.
And fortunately for our pair, when it comes to properties, size doesn't matter.
Beams are rather nice. Perhaps a little low, but we're only short.
Today, I'm in Devon at the Cobberton Combat Collection, which started off as one man's schoolboy hobby and has grown to encompass over 50 military vehicles and artillery pieces, as well as thousands of smaller items. This scout car behind me wears the colours of the local Royal Devon Yeomanry Regiment based in nearby Barnstable. And vehicles like this would have followed the 2nd Battalion to Normandy for the D-Day landings. Now, later on, I'll be meeting the men behind this impressive collection and seeing more of these magnificent machines. The County of Devon sits in the southwest of England. It shares three county borders, including Cornwall's, and meets the Bristol Channel to the north with the English Channel to the south. The southern coastline is dominated by both sandy beaches and fossil cliffs, whilst the northern edge is characterised by its sheltered coves fringed by rocky outcrops like those at Croyde and Woolacombe, as well as the dramatic dunes on display at Saunton Sands. Meeting the ocean in North Devon is Exmoor National Park, which spills into neighbouring Somerset. Moving inland, the historic market town of Barnstaple is the social centre of North Devon and was an important trading centre for wool and pottery in the 16th and 17th centuries. In fact, Barnstable pottery has been found in archaeological excavations as far away as Maryland in the USA. So, with its natural beauty and quaint villages, where pastel-coloured cottages are topped with thatched roofs, Devon is a county that showcases England at its very best. With miles of gorgeous coastline and wild moorlands that appeal to tourists and locals alike, you'd expect Devon to be an expensive place to live. Yet the average price of a detached property here is only around £13,000 above the national figure. Now, along with all this natural beauty, one of the biggest draws for many people is the famous Devon cream tea, which is estimated to contribute around £85 million a year to the local economy. But after all the activities today's buyers are planning with this move, will they have time for this delicious delicacy? Let's find out.
Former art teacher Maggie and her retired IT professional husband Martin met at school and have been together for 46 years.
Maggie is very creative. She is different to me in that she's a little less organised, perhaps a little bit more of an artistic temperament, let me say. But we make a good couple.
Martin's got quite strong opinions. He can be very forceful, but he's also a lot of charm.
After a lifetime of work, they've decided to live the dream and leave the 5-bedroom Stockport semi they've shared for over 30 years.
As happy living Stockport as we once were. We've both retired, so we don't have any particular reason to be hanging around this area. We live on a major road, which is busy. And although it's not particularly noisy, it does mean that we don't really have much of a community on this stretch of the road.
And after visiting the region, they've decided it's Devon they'd like to call home.
It's got the coastline, and I do love the coast. We want countryside. It's warmer down there, and I'm getting a bit old, so I don't really want to be enduring really cold winters. So Devon seems to offer all the things that we really like.
And when they move south, they're keen to devote more time to their hobbies, both outdoors and in.
When I retired, just under 2 years ago, I started to do some things that I hadn't done, but I've always wanted to. I took up pottery, and I take a pottery class once a week.
I'm a felt maker, but I'm also a fine artist, and I want to paint more. So I would like to be able to go out with my paints and sit on a hillside in Devon and paint the sea and paint the things I can see around me.
So with their heads full of ideas, this creative couple can't wait to get stuck into their new country life.
I think when we finally do it, then that will be the start of something new, but also the end of a chapter, and we'll be able to close that book and open the new book.
Maggie and Martin have decided to plant their arty roots in the northern half of Devon, so that's where we're focusing our search. But ahead of our quest to find them their dream home, I'm meeting them in the county to discuss the finer details of their requirements.
Well, Martin and Maggie, welcome to Devon, the two of you.
Thank you very much.
There is a sense of urgency with this house hunt, isn't there? Because I believe you got some good news yesterday.
We have exchange contracts. The downside, slightly, is that we have a completion date which is only 2 weeks away. So we are homeless in 2 weeks' time.
Right.
So, yes, I hope there's going to be something really good this week.
Nothing like being homeless in 2 weeks' time to really focus the mind with our houses.
Yes, that's right.
Right. What is it that you're after?
We want somewhere that is on the outskirts of a village, because we'd like people to talk to. We also want somewhere where we can have a studio.
So you're after a workshop. It's for both of you, isn't that
right?
That's
right, yes.
So a workshop is up there as a priority. But tell me about the actual house you're after as well.
We want a garden, somewhere I can grow vegetables. We want it to be light and airy, because we've had a big Victorian house, so we don't want to be sort of too claustrophobic moving to a smaller house. But we're fairly relaxed about the styles. We'd like a bit of a quirkiness, but
yep. How many bedrooms?
Three would be good.
What about views?
Oh, views are important. It's such a beautiful county, it'd be a shame not to be able to see it from the house.
So hypothetically, if one or two of the properties actually don't have a workshop already done, are you happy to take on a little bit of a project and build one yourselves?
Yes, we would certainly do that. We appreciate that it's not always possible to find something suitable.
So, what is our top budget? Why don't you remind us again what we're working with?
Ideally, it's going to be £350,000, but there's a bit of wiggle room.
Yes, I mean, if we can find somewhere with a good studio, so we don't have to spend a huge amount of money on that, I think we could probably run up to about £380,000 for the right property.
Well, we do have some splendid homes to show you. We know time is of the essence, so shall we get started?
Let's go.
Come on, then.
For their top budget of £380,000, Maggie and Martin want a character home with three bedrooms. The outside space is important and should offer options to grow fruit and vegetables, as well as a workshop in which to base their hobbies. Location-wise, they'd like a place where they can get stuck into the local community. The properties we've chosen will provide Maggie and Martin with a variety of styles, but it'll only be after they've seen each one that its price will be revealed. The final visit to the mystery house will require them to open their creative minds, but if they do, I think they'll be very pleasantly surprised. Our Devonshire property search is on its way to the village of Mortchard Bishop in the heartland of Mid-Devon. The village is overlooked by pastures green and dominated by the tower of the 16th century church of St Mary's, which, at 95 feet tall, stands almost 600 feet above sea level. There's a great sense of community here and a good selection of places to get to know the locals, including a popular dining pub. The car park here welcomes the post office van, which visits weekly after the village post office closed. Close to the centre of the village, we find this rather interesting property. Thought to date back to the 18th century, it sits neatly amongst its neighbours.
Right, let's see what you make.
Oh, wow.
Of this little offering.
Oh, this is interesting, isn't it?
Yes.
Fascinating.
Yes.
Sum up this property for me, will you, before we step inside?
Different.
Okay.
I was going to use the word quaint, but quaint. I probably shouldn't.
You can. No, we like that, quaint and different. Right, let's see what you make of the inside.
This unconventional attached cottage is set out in an L shape. It's been tastefully renovated, and the front door, set beyond the courtyard, leads us into the house where we find a snug dining room. We're heading to the right-hand wing of the property.
This is really what I wanted to start off with, the kitchen.
It's lovely. I really like it. It's not huge, but it's got everything. It's really nicely done.
Beautifully finished, I have to say.
To your taste.
Yes.
Yes, very much so.
Lovely.
Simple, elegant, but functional. Works well.
I thought I was talking about you for a minute there.
Right, I'm going to keep going.
Heading out of the kitchen, we're crossing through the dining room to a large sitting room with windows to the back garden.
This is nice.
It is, isn't it? This definitely counts as cosy, I would say.
Yeah. I can see you two sitting in this sitting room.
I think it's big enough to be properly usable, but still small enough to be cosy. And even with the beams, which bring the ceiling height down a little bit, it doesn't feel oppressive or claustrophobic. I do like it.
It is lovely. It's a really nice house.
Well, I've shown you the downstairs. I'm going to take us upstairs. Let's see what you make of the bedrooms.
OK.
Above the dining and sitting rooms are three bedrooms, all served by a smart family bathroom. There's a double with a sloped ceiling and a skylight, another with a feature window to the front, and the master benefits from garden views.
It's beautiful. It really is lovely.
So far, so good, I think.
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes.
And are you happy?
I think I'd be very happy living in this sort of space, so long as we've got some of the other things that we need.
Yes, so far, so good. Let's see what we make of the outside space and opportunities there.
Right, OK.
Outside, an arc of steps leads up from the house to landscape gardens, which include a large patio and a small pond, a summer house and shed, plus excellent views across neighbouring countryside.
I think quite a large garden, considering from the front of the house. It doesn't look like you've got anything, is it?
Exactly, yes. That's right. It's quite deceiving.
Now, I can see your eyes searching. They will have to search, I'm afraid, because I don't have a workshop to show you, but this land is flat. You could potentially build your own one here.
Yes. I think that's a possibility, certainly. I think we've always felt that if there was the land available and it didn't compromise the garden, that would be the right thing to do.
So I'm now wondering if we can put a price on this, former piggery, with this wonderful view and garden.
My feeling is we're probably about the top of the budget, plus, obviously, we need to build the studio, so I would guess probably about £350.
OK.
I'm going to be cheeky and hope it's a bit less and say £340.
Are you really hoping?
I'm hoping.
I like it when you're cheeky because you could actually be a little bit cheekier. The asking price is offers in excess of £250,000. How luxurious would you like your workshop to be with that spare money?
Wow.
That is stunning.
That is amazing. Yes.
Yes, I think that's quite a surprise.
Yeah? Yes. So do you fancy now being cheeky and having another look around on your own?
Oh, yes, definitely.
I love that smile. I love that smile. Be my guest, go and take another look around the property, then come back out and really study this area.
Yes.
And I'm sure you'll be drawing up plans in no time. And I'm going to keep everything crossed. Off
right,
you go.
Thank you.
Off you
go.
This 18th century cottage has rung in at £130,000 below budget. It's beautifully renovated, is full of character, and has three bedrooms. There's a large garden with views, plus the option to build a great workshop, and it lies close to the village centre.
This house is absolutely beautiful. It's been restored really sympathetically and with a sense of style. It is stunning, really a fabulous place.
It's quite a stunning property, I have to say, a real surprise. You can't tell from the outside what you're going to find. And it's just been so beautifully done. I think I was almost speechless, which for me is very, very unusual.
Have you seen enough?
Yes, it's a lovely, lovely house.
Yeah?
It really is beautiful.
Now, you said it was different and it was quaint. Seems to have delivered on all of those, doesn't it?
Yes.
That's quite a surprise.
Good. Yes. We like to do that to you. Let's hit the road.
Devon's beautiful backdrop has provided inspiration to countless craftspeople, and it's also proved a draw for our creative couple. They're excited about indulging in their passion for the arts within its boundaries. They've come to meet Marek Drazga, who was also drawn to the county over 20 years ago to base his bespoke architectural pottery business. They're meeting him at his studio on the outskirts of the village of Chittlehamholt, south of Barnstable.
A beautiful place.
Yeah,
fantastic.
Love it. Absolutely love it.
So what got you into pottery in the first place?
Most probably as a six-year-old kid in Cookham on Thames, seeing dragon finials.
Oh, wow. Right.
I was always interested in architecture. And then when I discovered it at art college in the early 20s, that was it.
Finials are designed to decorate the apex of a gabled roof. Creations such as Marek's finely crafted examples were popular in Gothic and Victorian times, but date back much further.
What do you particularly love about clay and pottery?
Everything. I just immerse myself in it, love it. Absolutely love it.
Although Marek's pottery is created in the Devonshire countryside, the consistency of the local clay isn't suitable for his work, so it's sourced from Stoke-on-Trent.
The sorts of things that you do, it's more of an architectural ceramics, really, isn't it?
Absolutely, absolutely. It's basically clay work for buildings, ridge tiles, chimney pots, finials, and bricks.
Marek has built up a global client list and makes each detailed piece to order. He's currently working on a collection of 16th century inspired chimney pots for a private client. When assembled, they stand at 5 feet tall. He uses a combination of traditional methods with his own techniques and is showing Maggie and Martin how to craft the top of the monumental pots.
The method I've developed, I call it skimming, and this is turning a round object into an octagonal, and it's basically pulling a template through the form.
Okay.
And skimming away the clay and progress all the way around, lightly at first.
Marek uses water to keep the clay lubricated.
And after a short period of time, you actually get a very sharp edge on the whole thing. So, if you want to give it a shot?
Yeah, well, yes, please, because I'm all togged up.
Right, there you go. Over to you. So if you keep it firmly down and pull towards... That's right, just lightly with that and pull towards yourself. Right, if you get it locked down at the bottom, pull towards yourself. Nice and steady, absolutely perfect.
Okay. Can I have a go then?
Oh, all right then. Here you are.
Thank you.
Change places.
Yeah. Right.
You stand that side and laugh at him.
Yeah, yep. Okay. So, holding on to
here. Yeah, that's it, yep. Get locked in, pull through, and then keep pressing it down.
You start to get a feel for it after a while, don't you?
After around 15 minutes of sculpting, the chimney top is a neat octagonal shape. Marek takes the reins again for the final stage.
All right, there we go. I think you've got the gist of it.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
And there's two put together, and that's what they should look like at the end.
Wow.
Sorry,
fantastic.
I've walked out.
That is brilliant. Yeah. Thank you so much for your time.
That's been wonderful. Absolutely tremendous. Thank you.
Full of inspiration, Maggie and Martin are even more determined to find a new place to call home where they can revel in their passions. It's a new day in Devon, and we're about to embark on the next leg of our journey, searching out a country paradise for Maggie and Martin from Stockport, where they can live the good life and let their creative juices flow. Armed with a top budget of £380,000, we're tasked with finding a characterful home that has a garden fit for the green-fingered, as well as an artist's workshop. There's still our marvellous mystery house to come.
I'm pretty much bowled over by this, I have to say.
Are you?
Yes.
And I'll be finding out how one pocket of Devon is safeguarding military memorabilia that tells the tales of the brave and victorious British Army during the Second World War.
It is an extraordinary experience just to stand here. Well, yesterday went rather well with Martin and Maggie, although there's nothing like being homeless in 2 weeks' time to help focus the mind. Today, we're going to show our crafty couple two properties, one of which being the What Could It Possibly Be mystery house. Well, let me give you a clue. It's rather gorgeous in a rural location, but will it give them everything they're after? Well, we'll have to wait and see, because first I'm going to show them a property that could be the answer to their creative and artistic dreams.
Our house hunt is taking us to the mid-Devon hamlet of Oldborough. Less than a 10-minute drive away is the village of Copplestone. Sitting in a valley and cutting through the village is the Tarka Line Railway, which runs from Exeter to Barnstable and is named after the 1927 novel Tarka the Otter. In the scenic hamlet of Oldborough is this Grade 2 listed cottage.
Right. May I present to you your property?
Ah, wonderful.
Thatch.
Yes.
But it's new thatch.
Yes.
It's only finished last year.
Right.
Yep.
So you've got, if you keep an eye on it and you make sure the ridge is always intact, you've got about 25 years there.
You'll also, probably see me out.
So before I take you inside, what is going through your minds?
It's beautiful.
It's a very, very pretty looking place, I have
yes,
to say.
It
very
is lovely.
Pretty.
Right, shall we?
Let's go.
Super.
This enchanting semi-detached cottage is built from cobble and stone and is thought to have its origins in the 16th century.
So, through the stable door, which leads us into our sitting room.
Lovely. Beautiful oak floor.
This is all new.
Yep.
Yeah, the house has had a massive overhaul over the last few years.
You can see a lot of work's been done on it. Mm. Beams are rather nice. Perhaps a little low, but we're only short, so, you know.
Super. Well, we'll keep going through. Next door is our kitchen.
Oh, this kept is nice.
Toasty warm by the range.
Yes.
Lovely.
Lovely.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. This is a nice area, though, because you've got the kitchen and the dining area, so, you know, it's sociable. And actually quite bright as well. It's, you know, with the
French doors.
Yes. It works, works well.
Well, overall, this kitchen is giving us a very good impression. I'm going to head upstairs now with the two of you.
OK, lovely.
Let's see what you think there.
The first floor has just as much charm as downstairs, and offers a compact bathroom with three bedrooms. A narrow room at the back is in use as a study. Then at the front, there's a beamed double. And next door is the master.
Well, I think it'd be fair to say this thatched house isn't huge, but you still get your three bedrooms.
Yeah.
Yes.
This is the master.
It's beautiful. It really is well thought out and stylish.
It's certainly interesting. We'll probably be in a better position to come to a view when we've seen a bit more.
That's a good point. Let's head outside and see what else there is
on
offer.
I'll lead on, shall I?
Yes, please. Thank you.
The outdoor space here provides everything Maggie and Martin have asked for. There are beautifully landscaped gardens featuring endless countryside views, and it's ideally equipped for living the good life and indulging in creative hobbies.
Wow.
That's what I wanted to hear. A little bit of wow, yeah.
That's definitely a view.
Yes, that is wonderful.
Now, the garden itself is about a third of an acre.
Yes.
A vegetable patch behind you.
Yes.
Plenty of space. You've got a pond. You've even got your own well.
Yep.
But I'm really getting to the main part, which is the workshop.
Yes.
Now, you might have noticed when we sort of walked into the house and then came out, it was to the side.
Yes.
At the moment, it's a huge double garage. Again, the owners don't use it to store their car. They use it for their hobbies. It has water and it has electricity. Mm, and it is pretty large.
Okay.
So let's see how much this thatched house is. A beautiful garden, views to die for. Well, let's see what his current asking price is, shall we? Who wants to go first?
It's my turn. We've been so wildly out. I'm expecting to be wild out, but I'm going to say 300,000.
OK. Martin?
I suspect that we're probably around 345.
You are very close.
Ooh. Ooh.
The asking price is £350,000.
OK.
And you are paying for being on the edge of a village.
Yes.
Right.
With those views.
OK.
I think you should have another look on your own.
Yes.
I don't know how long I'm going to give you in that workshop. I might put a timer on it. You might be in your element as you're looking around there.
Yeah.
And well, I'll meet you by the front door.
Lovely. Yeah,
thank
Lovely.
You.
Thank you very much.
See you in a minute.
Let's go.
This Grade 2 listed thatch cottage is not only £30,000 under budget, but it also comes complete with wonderful original features along with its three bedrooms. It's got character and style, a fabulous garden with raised beds, country views, and that all-important workshop.
It's a lovely house, it really is. It's got so much character, and the thatch is just beautiful.
I think the house is really nice. I think it's fairly compact. I think we would still struggle to get a lot of our stuff in here. I'm very taken with garden. I think the garden is fabulous, and the location is brilliant. And the workshop, I think there is definitely the embryo of something. It's the right sort of size, needs a little bit of work, but we could really use that. So I'm very, very positive about this. And I think there's probably enough left in the budget to give us a chance to do what we need to do.
OK, you two?
Yes.
Yeah,
indeed.
Finished here?
Yeah, I think so.
All right, thank you for getting the door, Martin. I think we're going to hit the road.
OK, let's go.
Not far from Barnstable, the small village of Cobberton is home to the Cobberton Combat Collection, a display of military memorabilia from British and Commonwealth countries that dates to the period between 1939 and 1945, when World War II raged. I've come to meet Preston Isaac, who founded the museum on the family farm in 1981.
Preston, good to meet you, sir.
Welcome to Cobberton. Beautiful sunny morning.
It's always like this in Devon, isn't
it? Every day, every
day. Blue skies, sunshine.
Yes, always.
But as you come in here, I've already spied one of those tanks. So impressive. Yeah. I mean, but how did it actually start?
Little boy collecting things.
A little boy collecting things, and it has got out of hand, hasn't
yeah,
it?
Literally, yeah.
What about the military angle? When did that come
started,
in?
Yeah, I mean, Dad was in Home Guard, and used to hear bits and pieces, and it's just a natural progression.
Preston's father passed on militaria from his war days that helped start his collection. And with the thousands of items ranging from a military button to a 50-ton tank, every piece tells a tale.
If you had a particular favourite, I'm going to put you on the spot, what would it be out of the whole collection?
It's a Churchill tank, which is quite symbolic.
And how long with a vehicle like that, if it's constantly looked after and restored, how long will it last for?
Oh, they make... main hull will last forever. You're talking about armour 6 inches thick.
Preston's collection has stood the test of time, and now it's his son Tim who's at the helm.
I knew the collection was going to be vast, but I didn't quite appreciate it's going to be so many artillery pieces here.
Well, yes, it's been 40, maybe 50 years of collecting.
And we are surrounded by tanks here. And when I spoke to Preston, your father, he mentioned yes. his particular favourite was the Churchill tank.
The Churchill, yes.
I mean, I don't think... Am I allowed to touch it?
Yeah.
I don't think I've ever been close to a tank before. And, you know, you get the impression that they're going to be huge, but this is quite enormous. It's also pretty intimidating to be standing next to it.
It is.
Named after then-Prime Minister Winston Churchill's family, Preston bought this tank in the 1970s for a few hundred pounds. It weighs in at 44 tonnes.
There were several hundred of them, all dumped in a scrapyard, just waiting for the price of steel to go up after the war.
Preston may only have paid the scrap price for the tank, but just recently Tim was offered over £100,000 for it by a private collector. He said no.
Do we have any idea when it was actually built?
It was built in October 1944, so it was It was built for the final thrust of World War II from D-Day and further on.
So it would have seen some serious action?
I would think so.
And how many crew would have operated a tank like this?
There's a five-man crew, the driver, hull gunner in the front, and then the commander, the loader gunner and the radio operator.
So would the crew have spent hours upon hours in this tank, working together as a close unit?
They did. We've in fact met a radio operator who worked in a Churchill tank from D-Day onwards, and he became very close to the other four men in the tank. They were a family.
It's pretty awe-inspiring standing amongst these vehicles of war, but I'm lucky enough to be getting the opportunity to hop on board this self-propelled gun to get first-hand experience from up top.
So this isn't a tank?
It's an artillery gun which has been mounted onto a tank chassis simply to propel itself around the battlefield.
I mean, it is brutally basic. Standing here, you get a feeling of being quite exposed. There's no ceiling to it. Why would that have been?
Simply because we're slightly behind the front line, firing a barrage of fire over the infantry onto the target.
My goodness.
So we've got armoured sides and maybe a canvas roof if it were raining.
Well, I'd love to see it move, that's for sure. Thank you, Tim.
OK.
You really do get a sense of what it must be like. We're standing here and it's an impressive piece of kit, but to think this would have been operated with shells coming overhead, men dying on either side, it is an extraordinary experience just to stand here.
Built in Canada from steel, with an aircraft engine, 2,000 of these vehicles were used by the British Army during World War II. And this mighty mover weighs in at around 30 tonnes, with top speeds of around 25 miles an hour. The vehicles in the collection are often taken to military shows and also feature in films. One even starred alongside Hollywood icon Brad Pitt, so I'm pleased to say I'm in good company. But for now, it's time to get back to my house hunting companions and continue with their property search. The North Devon hamlet of Churchill is the final property stop on our house hunt. It's our most remote location, but just a few minutes' drive away is the village of East Down, which provides a village hall to unite the local community and a great gastropub. Churchill sits in rural isolation with far-reaching views across agricultural land, home to an abundance of wildlife. Our mystery house may be remote, but what it lacks in neighbours and community, it makes up for in many other ways.
So, for our final time in a way, here's your property, our mystery house.
Mm.
Yes.
Yes, indeed.
Two yeses. It's about 200 years old.
It looks a reasonable size, actually, I think.
Yes.
Certainly an interesting location.
Well, I think you hit the nail on the head there, haven't you? Because for our mystery house, we have brought you much further afield. We've gone more north,
yes,
but much more rural, surrounded 360 by views.
There's a lot about this sort of location that appeals to me, and the house, yeah, it looks solid.
Great.
Yeah.
Right, well, I think we should start, don't you?
Yes, please.
This delightful property was extended in 1998, which doubled its size to create the sunny, airy home we're about to discover.
Please come in. Let's see what you make of our mystery house inside.
Our first impressions. It's a lovely size.
Yes.
A beautiful size room.
I find the internal windows intriguing.
This must have been two rooms and out that the back outside wall.
Yes. You'd be right, that's the exterior wall. This was probably two rooms.
Yes.
And they've kept that as a feature when they've extended the house.
Lovely.
So really bright, roomy, spacious.
Yes.
Just off to our left, up those stairs, is a study, really good sized study with again sort of dual aspects, so you get plenty of light in there and views.
This works, this does work for us.
Absolutely. I'm pretty much bowled over by this, I have to say.
Are you?
Yes, it's got that sort of openness that you don't always get in the cottages. And, love it. Absolutely love it.
Yep.
Oh, music to my ears. Let's keep going.
At the back of the house and divided by an open stairway is the kitchen diner.
Oh, yes.
I like the kitchen.
That's good. This is a great space.
Yes.
The kitchen's lovely, but also having the diner there where, all right, you've got a little staircase in between, but it's sociable.
Yes.
You know, if you've got friends around or even one of us is cooking and that, it's just a good sociable space.
Yeah.
Yes.
It does work very, very well.
Yes. So we're liking the kitchen, we're liking the dining area, we're liking everything we're seeing. In addition to this, if you just look past, you can see there's a doorway that leads outside, but also you've got your utility room there.
Lovely.
And I want you to remember that room because it could prove quite important later on.
Right. Okay.
Right. That's a big hint, wasn't
it?
Yes,
I was going to say, that's subtle, yes.
Yes. Yeah. But have you seen enough downstairs?
Yes. Let's go and have a look
up. Lovely.
Above us, there's a surprise waiting for Maggie and Martin. Along with a tiled family bathroom are four bedrooms, meaning there are already options for a creative workplace. At the back of the house, there's a dual aspect
I know you didn't ask for an ensuite, but do you like the idea of having one?
Yes, particularly when you've got guests. It does make life a little easier.
I think it's always a bonus. It's not something we would necessarily expect, but you know, any bonus is good.
Good. So, overall, how would you rate this property inside?
It's very, very good. Really, I think it's got pretty much what we've been asking for, so long as we can sort out workshop. And so definitely, fingers crossed, this would be a goer for us, I think.
Now, we're going to head back downstairs, but you two are creative. I want your imagination to work with the next thing I'm going to show you.
OK.
The outside space sits to the front with a lawn and a terrace, perfect for enjoying the warmer months. The house also enjoys spectacular views across Exmoor National Park.
Now, let's talk in a little bit more detail about the garden, the property, and also the potential for a workshop. I think I've given it away there, haven't I?
Yes.
The potential for a workshop. The way it's set up at the moment, you do have like a small barn at the side.
Mm-hmm.
I'm guessing that might not be quite big enough for what you're after. However, you've got a shed the other side of it, but you have all that land that, in a way, is to the side of the house. It's not going to spoil the view. It's not going to detract from the property. Could be the potential there of putting a really big workshop in, and you could have it connected to the house if you wanted to.
Yes, I think there's certainly the opportunity
to
put something there. There's somewhere to put it.
I do think it's a lovely, lovely building. It has the potential to work for us. I think it could be a lovely home.
Well, let's see what price we're going to put on our lovely home. What are we thinking?
Well, I've been way out every time that I've guessed so far, but I'm going to go to the top of our budget. I think it's going to be about $375.
Okay.
Bearing in mind the fact that we do have to do some work for a workshop and we do need some budget, I'm going to hope around about $360.
You're both actually very close, because the asking price is £369,000.
Okay.
Yes.
That's squeezing it.
Yes.
But I guess we probably knew that we would be squeezing it at some point.
Yes.
Would you like to take another look around?
Yes,
please.
Please do the gardens, the potential for that all important workshop, and well, come and find me when you're ready.
Okay, yes. Lovely. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
This double-fronted cottage is £11,000 under budget and offers a bright and roomy living space, plus character features and four bedrooms. It has wonderful views from the garden and there's also the potential to create a workshop. The mystery house may be remote, but it's perfectly packaged.
I think this house is absolutely lovely. It's been redeveloped in a sensitive way with a great sense of style. It's light, it's airy, and it's quirky. It's lovely.
I think the house is great. I really do. I think it's a big house. There's room for what we need. I like it a lot.
It is so beautiful out here today.
It's lovely.
Oh, when the sun's shining, glorious.
Yep.
Amazing views, but I'm going to have to pull you two away now, I'm afraid. Let's go somewhere where you two can have a chat on your own first. I'll join you and you can tell me what your next move's going to be.
Right.
Okay.
Well, we know Martin and Maggie need to find a new home, but will they be moving into any of our properties here in Devon? Let's find out. Well, Martin and Maggie, I wonder how we've done here in Devon for you. Have we found you your next home?
I think we might. You might well have done.
Sharp intake of breath. OK, but which one in particular took your fancy?
I think the one that is highest on our list is undoubtedly the Mystery House. I think it's a beautiful house.
Yep.
We need to work out how we would handle the workshop. And we're also a little bit uncertain about the location because it is a little bit more remote.
It is.
Yes. I'm going to need to go and walk around the area and see how I'd be able to sort of connect with neighbours and what sort of community there is down the hill.
Yeah.
That is a beautiful place and a beautiful, beautiful house.
Oh, I'm so delighted. Did you get that feeling that you could be creative and have a lovely life at that property?
Oh, yes. It is a lovely house, lovely atmosphere in the house.
Well, it's all sounding very promising. But what is the next important step for you two?
Well, we have had a quick chat with the owners.
Already?
Yes.
Indeed. and we are going to go back and have another look. We're keen enough to get back and look at it in more detail.
That's tomorrow.
My goodness, well, that is delightful. I leave you literally for a couple of hours and this is what happens. Well, I hope all your questions get answered. That second viewing is as successful as the first.
Thank you.
And who knows, in a few weeks, a few months' time, well, we know you're going to be residents of Devon, but you might be living in that splendid Mystery House.
Yes.
You will let us know how you get on, won't you?
Oh, we will.
Of course.
Delightful. Thank you both so very much.
And thank you.
Thank you very much, too.
Well, I think mentally, both Maggie and Martin have left Stockport way behind and physically are certainly a big step closer to a new life here in Devon. They've loved all the locations that we've shown them, but I am so happy that they've already been in touch with the owners of our Mystery House and are having a second viewing very, very soon. I so hope it works out for them. And I'll see you again on Escape to the Country.
Maggie and Martin did revisit the Mystery House, and although they still loved it, they decided it was a little too remote for them. But I'm happy to report that they've since had an offer accepted on a detached cottage with a workshop in North Devon. If you would like to escape to the country in Northern Ireland, Scotland, Wales or England and need our help, please apply online at bbc.co.uk/beonashow.